My novel in English is called Odds Against Tomorrow. It's about a character named Mitchell Zucker, a brilliant mathematician who is obsessed with worst-case scenarios. He's a very anxious person, and he gets what would seem to be his dream job, but also a kind of worst nightmare job. After college, he works at a financial firm where his job is to predict worst-case scenarios. And then one day, a worst-case scenario comes to pass in New York City, where he lives, and he's realizes that he's uniquely prepared to profit from it. And so it's the realization of his nightmare, but it's also an incredible opportunity. I had a conversation with a friend of mine who, in college, was a very serious communist. He was French, actually, Parisian, and he formed a communist magazine. And after college, he went to law school and sort of became slowly de-radicalized and began working at a corporate law firm in downtown Manhattan. But he still had some part of him that was a kind of rebelling against the system. We would have lunches periodically in lower Manhattan, and he would show up in his fancy suit, and I would be wearing my t-shirt and jeans, and he would tell me stories about the kinds of things he was seeing in the world of high finance. And it was right before the financial crash, so it was about 2007. But there already was this sense that there was a lot of chicanery going on in the world of high economics. And he told me about this very cynical strategy that corporations were using in New York, especially because after September 11th, it was almost impossible to get catastrophe insurance. And so they were going through these kinds of semi-legal loopholes in order to protect themselves in case another disaster came. And I found this totally fascinating. And it gave me the idea for the company that's at the heart of the novel, Future World. I think fears of an oncoming apocalypse is a very primitive fear, and I think it's been with us since biblical times or earliest recorded history. In old myths, you see these fears, you see the flood myth is ancient. I mean, when I was writing the book, I read I didn't just go back and read Genesis and read of Noah, but ancient Sumerian flood myths and Mesopotamian flood myths and Egyptian and so on, and they're all very similar. And I think they all come out of the same anxiety. And of course, if you follow it through sort of Western literature, you see it as a recurring motif. And sometimes it's connected to fear of a plague, perhaps in Europe. I think in World War II and afterwards, it becomes more about the Cold War and fear of a nuclear apocalypse. I think you see it very strongly in the 80s and you know, Don DeLillo's work, for instance, like White Noise, I kept coming back to when I was writing this book because it's about a lot of the same ideas. But what's changed now is that even as society and civilization has continued to advance and we're in a generally good place and that we are healthier, we live longer, we're safer, there's also this unprecedented flood of information that we're presented with every day. And so it's not necessarily that we're in more danger, and in some ways we're in much less danger than we used to be. I mean, I'd rather be alive now and not in the 14th century when a plague was coming to my village, you know. But we now know more about everything that can go wrong than we've ever known before. I think that's changed, the bombardment, the constant bombardment of fear, and it's become part of the culture, where it's the currency of the culture. It's not only in every news program, at least in America. You can't turn on the news without being told of some horrific thing that might happen, is on the verge of happening. But it's in social media. It's every time you check your email, there's some alert. You're constantly receiving alerts, at least. In the U.S. email, I feel like I'm always getting alerts, which probably used to be reserved for things like, you know, your village, a herd is coming for your village, or the lion has escaped, but now it's, you know, an inch of snow or something. And so I think that's changed, and I think as a result, it's changing the way that we process this information. So what I was most interested in is that question of how do we deal with this onslaught of scary information? How does it change the way we think? Do we blot it out? Do we become obsessed and paranoid like Mitchell in my novel? Do we choose some middle ground? And I think those are questions that everybody has to answer for oneself. I recently read Margaret Atwood's Mad Atom trilogy, sort of futuristic, uncanny trilogy that I found fascinating and beautiful and scary and also very funny and magical, like all her work is.